Intersex has been added into the LGBTI rainbow family, so it's the I at the end. It doesn't mean invisible, it means intersex.
Have you heard of intersex? Do you know what it is?
No, sorry, I'm not gonna guess.
No. Not a clue.
Intersex. It rings a bell.
No, I don't actually. And I've been out for nearly 20 years and I've got no idea.
This is Mardi Gras!
It's Faraday, which is like the Sydney Mardi Gras festival, you know? It kind of makes sense for us to be here to be able to tell people what intersex is so they can find out more and actually meet real people.
If you don't mind me asking, do anyone of you identify as intersex?
I identify as female, but I am intersex. I have XY chromosomes, so I have an intersex body.
Yeah, I think it's really important to be visible. More so than being invisible, we've probably been erased to be more to be the point.
Intersex is a natural variation of people's chromosomes or hormone levels, which mean that they're not typically male or female.
Intersex, or disorders of sex development, or some people even call it differences in sex development, is an umbrella term for a range of conditions where there's been a divergence in the development of the sex chromosomes, genital anatomy, or the gonads. These conditions affect up to 2% of the population.
There's so many people out there that have this legacy of secrecy, of shame, of dealing with stigma, and there's so much silence about intersex still.
Can be quite shameful, and that shame sort of perpetuates this whole idea of intersex actually being fixed in society, so it stops actually even being there anymore.
I'm the president of OII Australia. We promote human rights and bodily autonomy for people with intersex variations.
So what are you up to next during the Mardi Gras period?
One of the key human rights issues is not really the existence of binary genders, but what is done to us medically to make us conform to those norms.
I think the anxiety around intersex starts really early because most people expect a boy or a girl. There's been a trend to be able to fix that social anxiety, even though there's not necessarily always a medical emergency that happens with intersex. Like for me, I don't think that I actually really ever had a sick body that needed to be treated. Do you know, I had a body that didn't really conform to expectation of what a female body should look like. I have an intersex variation that's referred to as complete androgen insensitivity syndrome. I present female, identify as being female, look female. I stand, for all other reasons, female. Except I don't have a uterus and I don't have ovaries, I had testes. And my vagina was blind, so it means that it didn't lead to a uterus.
This is where an individual has an XY chromosome pattern, but they have a genetic condition where the male hormones in the body don't act on the body, hence a female appearance.
I grew up thinking that I couldn't actually tell anyone about it because they wouldn't understand, and that it was my fault and it was something that was secret within our family and only our family. I didn't really understand how prevalent intersex actually really is. Doctors convinced my mother that it was the right thing to do to have my undescended testes removed when I was 11, I think.
Previous practice was to remove the testes before puberty because they were not thought to be needed and also have a cancer risk.
The statistics that were used in order to explain that to my parents were incredibly high, like 50% or something like that. Now it seemed to be that the risk is actually quite low. I remember lying down with a gown on and a whole room full of doctors and someone talking about my body and about me like I wasn't even there. And you know, they were like, so we're just going to have a little look now, and like they insert either their fingers or something else into me, and that really resonates as a really bad thing. That's kind of like, I feel like that's a kind of rape experience, you know, like but different because it was so clinical. They did the surgery and it healed and went back to school and had to make up all of these lies about like the great holiday that I'd had and things that I'd done. That was kind of the beginning of like starting to have to tell a whole bunch of lies about myself, do you know, in order to stop people guessing the truth about who, like what my body was or who I was. My parents consented to it. It created a lot of guilt for my mother for a long time. We've had to talk about it a lot. I feel like that surgery created more health problems for me than it fixed.
We now know that if we keep the testes in the abdomen, the testosterone that they produce gets converted to estrogen and helps to feminise that person's appearance. If those testes are removed, they need lifelong replacement of hormones.
Hello, how are you today? Can I finish this script? Yep, all right.
I know other XY women that haven't had that surgery. They actually have their own natural hormones in their bodies.
You know how to use it?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You've done it before.
Yeah.
I lament not having that. Not having that sense of wholeness that I knew what my base state was. Instead, I have to play chemical cocktail lab in my own body.
Outcomes for people with intersex or DSD haven't always been great. Certainly, one would hope that the patients that we're treating now and the families that we look after now would hopefully have less of these issues.
We discovered our daughter was intersex when she was 9 years old. I feel the need to be anonymous because this isn't actually about me, it's about my daughter. The GP had referred us on to a paediatrician, so thought that our daughter had two hernias. And after going through ultrasounds, it was discovered that they were testes. It was a feeling of loss that the daughter who we had suddenly discovered something that might not sort of mean she was who we thought she was. So as a parent, that was hard to deal with. I was very emotional for a long time, for months.
I think for parents, it's probably one of the most stressful experiences that they go through. Questions of how that child will fit into school, will they go through puberty normally, will they be able to have satisfying relationships, will they be able to have children?
So it turned out to be 5-alpha reductase deficiency. When a child reaches puberty, her body could start to masculinize. She could start to get body hair. Usually where females would have very little body hair, her voice could deepen. Her body might start to take the shape more of a male. We started to tell our daughter about her body when she was around 10, and really just the basics, that inside her body, instead of having ovaries, she had testes, so she wouldn't be able to have a baby. She actually took that surprisingly well. She actually came out with the comment, "That means I'm unique." And I thought, oh, thank goodness.
Children are very accepting of variations and differences, and it's important that we keep them informed throughout their childhood. There's appropriate disclosure at developmentally appropriate times in a child's life.
The surgery came up fairly quickly. So thank goodness she was 13 at the time and old enough to contribute to that discussion. She told us that she liked her body the way that it was. She didn't want her body to change at all. So she wanted to have the testes removed. That was a huge decision because as a mum, I didn't want to take anything away from her body that was hers, that was part of her, that made her who she is. However, she wanted the testes removed and she identified as being female, so we supported her in that decision. I feel fortunate that our daughter was at an age where we were able to talk with her about it. I feel that our family is one of the lucky families. But I mean, who knows what the future holds with her? When she's in her 20s, she might feel content, she might feel that she made the right decision, she might not. I don't know, but we'll deal with those things as they arise.
In my personal circumstance, I feel like the surgery caused me nothing but problems. You know, maybe I would have decided when I was a bit older that I would like them out. And like deciding that is, you know, on my own terms is a completely different thing to having that done to me.
So certainly in the past, care has been variable, and these are areas that the medical profession are now looking to improve.
There isn't an homogenous clinician perspective about what happens. In fact, there is a lot of variation in terms of what actually happens on the ground.
I'd like to think that things are really have improved in terms of medical treatment towards intersex infants and adults alike, but it's hard to really know.
Most people with intersex conditions don't talk about it. They don't come out and talk about it. So how are we to know who's happy with surgery and who gets to a point where they think, you know what, that shouldn't have been done?
Stigma is an issue. We think we have to address that stigma rather than changing people's bodies to make them suffer less, you know? And one of the key things I want to try and tell people about is just how diverse we are. We know we're not talking about a third sex with a third kind of body, we're talking about a huge range of diversity.
Together, I think we can raise awareness because the stigma arises from society that doesn't understand. And hopefully outcomes will be better for current generations of children coming through.
I'd really love it if intersex people could just have that real sense of pride that could go along with knowing who they are and what they are and being totally okay with that and seeing it as being like a blessing.
Let them enjoy their bodies. Celebrate that difference.